welcome to podcast number two for the Camel Matrix. I'm going to change it up a little bit because some new information has come to me that will kind of change how I'm doing some of my Camel comparisons. And so basically, a few weeks ago, one of my subscribers chimed in and let me know that on the Wired to Hunt podcast that Dr. Bradley Cohen was doing, they were having a conversation on some experiments that had been done by, I believe it was the University of Georgia at that time, with a focus on deer vision. And they were going through this conversation, also had some information on hunting camo. And so I figured that it would be pretty important that I give it a listen. So since I try to have as many camo patterns as I can for everybody to compare in as much of an unbiased presentation as possible, I gave it a listen, and what I heard was information that I knew that I needed to use and change how I share all these camel patterns with you, and basically how they appear in my version of deer vision. And so if you're curious about how Dr. Cohen used a Pavlovian type experiment, that's somewhat of a classic conditioning experiment to determine deer, what color a deer can see, you know, give the podcast a listen. Wired Hunt is available on any of the platforms that have podcasts. If you haven't heard it, then give it a listen. It's pretty informative. And I'll have a link to be able to get the information on that below. But so, you know, there was a study, and the study was called Behavioral Measure of Light Adapted Visual Sensitivity of White-Tailed Deer. Now, I'll also have a link to this document, and of course, now you'll have to pay to be able to see it. And I think that funding ultimately goes towards more research in that realm. But I'll at least give you the ability to go and take a look at it and see it for yourself. Now, if you've ever researched deer vision, you know, it can get confusing as to what deer can and cannot see, and that information has kind of changed over the years. The biggest change was when they actually introduced blaze orange as something that deer have a problem distinguishing between greens and reds, and so it actually helped save quite a bit of hunters' lives when they introduced that. So, I'll say that no matter what I do and how I alter my presentation based on this information, that I'll never really be able to truly give you a representation of what deer really see. I mean, we really don't know exactly how they see and how these light waves are interpreted by their brain, but through this experiment that they could determine what that color range was, how they really see it, we don't really know. But we can kind of get close, and then hopefully this information will help us better conceal ourselves when we're hunting and picking out our camo. So what we know is deer have a form of red-green color blindness, and from what Dr. Cohen stated, that their world is mostly shades of yellow and blue, and then with an emphasis on blue. They see a very broad range of blue light waves that we necessarily don't see. Our brain filters them out. And they also, he said they see a touch of green also. So that's not it's going to be a green weakness, but not necessarily a green blindness. And of course, that blue is going to be the most useful to them during their activity, which is their most activity, which is going to be dawn and dusk, which is where, you know, we usually see them. That's our hot time of the hunt season or the hunt day. So I'll be adjusting my deer vision versions to reflect more of color blindness conditions that make it hard to differentiate reds and greens. So basically, I'll take color spectrum that looks like this, which is kind of a spectrum color wheel, and it'll appear more like this, which you can see that it's got a lot of yellows where the greens and reds and it kind of fades into purple. And then you kind of have, it's almost like a grayish color in those realms where the two kind of bleed into each other. Now, we don't necessarily know if that's what they really see, but that's maybe the best representation of what it is that we can do with the tools that we've got. And, you know, Dr. Cohen may want to change that a little bit more. I actually did reach out to him, and so we'll see if he responds. And if he responds and, you know, makes some suggestions, I might see if I can adjust a little bit more, or we'll just be able to really continue with what it is that we're doing. So in addition to this, you know, we could actually enhance some of the blues, or maybe even a blue hue or a glow, you know, if a pattern has a lot of bright colors, just simply because if your pattern may be somewhat reflective, they may see that reflection of light as a blue light, and especially if your hunting camo has a UV brightener in it. So that would really make that pattern glow more of a bluish color if it's got light colors in it. So that's some of the changes that we may be making, or that I will be making. Now, the color information is great, but along with that, it's another big thing is their vision clarity. Dr. Cohen stated that deer have a vision that would test out to about 2100. And so to give you an idea what that looks like, you know, here's a 2020, and then next to it, this would be a 2100. And so, you know, that's a pretty blurry world. So we're going to adjust for that. And so if we take the world that looks like this to us, and so this is just a screenshot from one of my most recent videos. So you take that image and you look at it, and that's the colors that we would see if you're not colorblind. If you can see all the spectrums from reds and blues and yellows, and then everything kind of in between there, then this is what you're going to see. And so if we add that 2100 vision to it, now granted this is a flat image, this is not 3D, then that type of blurring gives you something that looks like this. I mean, and that really makes it a blurry world. But if that's your normal world, and if that's the way that you live, then, you know, you're going to function fairly well in there. And you know, so the example would be like, you know, if you're someone like me where your vision is changing slowly over time and you're having to have it corrected, then, you know, you may not notice that your vision has changed for the worse. And so, and you function with that vision, and then you go and you get it checked and you get lenses and all of a sudden you can see in a much better clarity. You're like, wow, you know, how could I not know that I wasn't seeing like that? And that's just simply because we adjust to that world. And that blurry world is what deer have lived in their entire life. And so it's something that they're used to. So this is just going to be a change I'm going to be making. I've been keeping it clear for everybody to evaluate, but moving forward with deer vision, we're going to try to be a little bit more accurate. So that 2100 blur is going to be in my presentations. So you say, wow, well, you know, how do I get busted all the time if their color range really isn't that broad? And on top of that, they can't see very well. Well, you know, imagine an animal that's hunted basically from the time that it's born, and you're afraid of pretty much everything that's moving that you haven't been taught by the others that are around you that, you know, it's a bad shape. So things that they may not be fearful of, which would be turkeys or squirrels or birds, and in some cases moving traffic, but, you know, until you step out of that vehicle. But for the most part, they're not afraid of those particular shapes. But if you take a dark blob or a light blob that is an area that didn't have a blob before, then that means that, you know, something's off to them, and they're going to, you know, be fearful of that. So, you know, to pick out blobs in their environment means that they have a pretty good spatial awareness. And that means that, you know, they are used to how something looks. And if something is off in that area, then they're not necessarily going to give you the opportunity to hurl an arrow or hot lead at them. So, you know, a good example would be, let's say that in your own house you've got a gray wall, and you know, it looks, you know, something like this. And every day you go in that room and that gray wall is there. And all of a sudden something is, you know, changed on that wall, and something that's trying to conceal itself, but it's not, you know, a perfect concealment. It's kind of there, but let's say they take a gray photo frame that's the same color as your wall with a gray image behind it, and all this is a gray image of that wall color. Well, that's what this would look like. You immediately would pick it out. You would say, you know, something is up. And that's, you know, especially if every time you walk in that room, you're making sure that you're not going to get ambushed. And that's how they live their life. You know, they are constantly scanning to see if something is going to come after them. And so, you know, they're going to notice that blob that wasn't there. You know, let's go over the changes. And, you know, here you can see a screenshot of my most recent video of Oscam versus Cryptek Highlander. And, you know, that's my human vision version. And so let's apply. This would be my regular deer vision. And so this is how I've been changing them. And so you can see that it's kind of grayed out. There's not really many yellows that are in there, but you know, it's that grayish spectrum that's between the blues and yellows that we saw. But if we take a look at some coloring based on the study, I'll go ahead and adjust it for that red-green colorblind condition. You know, some could be called protanopia, and another would be deuteranopia, and that just depends on how well they pick up either greens or how well they can't distinguish greens from reds. I'm kind of going in between those two types of color blindness, and I get this version. So this would be something that might be a little more accurate based on his study that shows that they might see much more yellow. And then, of course, you know, the blues in there, you know, you've got those grays that are back in there that's going to be in that middle area that's between the blues and the yellows. So let's go ahead and adjust that to 2100. So here's the 2100. And again, this is a flat image. This is not, you know, this is not three-dimensional. Wow, that's a blurry world. But this is the world that they're used to. And so they're used to that space. They're used to those things being blurry. So this is just how they have existed in their current evolutionary state and how they've thrived. So, you know, they are going to notice those differences. They're going to use their other senses to also enhance how they live and stay safe in their own environment. And so moving forward, what does that mean for this channel and for the Camel Matrix? Well, for me, it means a lot of work, just because I need to go in and change a lot of these images to reflect what these color changes and what this blurriness is going to do. And for you, it just means more accurate representations of how deer see the hunting camo in different environments. So you may ask, you know, how can I use this to help me? Well, your camo is such a small factor in concealment. And as hunters, we want to take every single advantage we can get. So using my videos or the Camo Matrix, find something that you like. And if it's in your budget, and if it's a quality piece of clothing that keeps you in the field longer and was designed for hunting and made for hunting without the use or at least minimal use of UV brighteners in the fabric, then, you know, make that choice and choose that particular hunting camo. Now, of course, something that you think looks cool is great too. And that often that's what we usually go with. So in addition to that, you know, these are the six things that really, you know, along with your camo can make you more successful. And we all know these things. Work the wind. That's the number one thing. If your wind is going in this direction, this is the direction that deer are going to be coming in from, then you're never going to see them, or they're going to smell you a long way away. Be still. You know, they've got their eyes on the side of their head. They're a scanning animal. They're going to be looking for any kind of movement that's out there. Be quiet. Now, they may not necessarily have the best hearing in the world. They've got hearing about like what we've got, but you know, extra noises are going to give you away. Not skylining yourself or not having a backdrop is going to be another key. So if you're out in the open and nothing is behind you, or you're in a tree and nothing is behind you in the sky, then you're going to stand out no matter how good your camo is and no matter how well you think you blend into that tree. And then use cover, so something in front of you also. So if you can block yourself a little bit to make yourself kind of blend into that front foreground and that background, that's going to be optimal. And then only move when they move. When they stand there, they are scanning that environment, making sure that there's nothing that's in there that's going to get them. But when they move, everything is moving. So that's your time to draw your bow or to get yourself into a better position. So if you can, you know, please subscribe so that as I post these new video comparisons, that you'll be able to see these new deer vision simulators that can help you see how different camo might perform in different areas. And you know, hit the notifications if you can. It'll let you be alerted as to, you know, when these new videos are available. And also, if you wish to support the channel, it's really easy. So purchasing any kind of these hunting products through any of my affiliate links gives you basically what you're looking for, and I might get a little bit of a cut out of that just to help support this channel. And it's no extra cost to you. Now, one particular one, you can shop through Sportsman's Warehouse. You can get any kind of thing that you need for hunting. Just use my affiliate link and go shop their website just as you would any other time. As for camos that I have affiliates with, take a look at, and I'll throw an image up here of all of them in the new Deer Vision simulation that I'm kind of working on. So for Osseo, for Canis Athlete, Furlough, Quiu, Cryptek, Numa Outdoors, Scentlock. Now Scentlock, they use a number of different things. This one will be probably, this is going to be a Realtree Escape, or Xscape, how they put it. So Realtree Escape in Scentlock, and then True Timber, I will most likely do Strata. So that's going to be this list of camo that's up there. Something else, if you're a bow hunter, Faradine Outdoors, a good place to find bow hunting products and a number of other hunting products. If you're looking at mapping or digital hunting tools, either HuntStand or Onyx, both, you can take a look at those through my affiliate links. Binos, Eyewear, Scopes, Loophold. I use their binos and some of their glasses. It's pretty good stuff. They've been around for quite a while. They have good warranty on their products. If you're someone that likes to use scent eliminators, give Scent Crusher a look. Purchasing from these gets you what you want, no extra fees, and a little bit goes towards keeping this channel running and active. Thanks again for watching. You know, hit the like button for me, and remember that the best camo is to remain still and be quiet. But if you look cool, that's pretty good too. Thank you.